Dr. Brennan Jacoby, we are very happy to have you here in the DMEXCO TV studio. Welcome. Could you kindly tell us a little bit about yourself, who you are, and what you're actually doing?
Yeah, thank you so much. It's great to be here. So I'm a philosopher and the founder of Philosophy at Work, which works with businesses on how they think and then how that thinking affects what they do. So we get right into things like meaning and purpose and understanding, so that whatever products, relationships we're building when we're connecting with people, we're making sure that it's really substantive and we've got a firm foundation before we go too far down the wrong track.
Okay, so do you have an example or a best practice case that you could share with us?
Yeah, sure. So, for example, this morning I gave a talk at DMEXCO on the philosophy of trust.
Okay.
And trust, of course, the topic of DMEXCO this year. Trust is also something that I did my PhD on, so it's
okay.
Something that I've been working a long time around. But it's a great test case because trust brings with it so many connotations.
Mm-hmm.
So, for example, I grew up in America, in Detroit, and all the money in America says right on it, "In God we trust."
Yeah.
And so whatever trust is, I think growing up there for me, it started having some sort of religious connotations or political connotations. And that's just an example of how trust brings so much with it. But it's not just unique to trust, any concept. We're talking about purpose, identity, value. All of these things have a lot of meaning.
Yeah.
And for us to do something positive, before we execute, before we do, we need to be clear that we're thinking about things really well. So for example, when I work with clients on how they build trust, the first thing we do is to say, so what does trust mean to you? What do you think trust means to your users and your clients? Because before we can navigate trust and try to build it, we have to know what we're talking about. So a lot of times, philosophy comes in at that ground zero level, at that point of saying, what are we even talking about? How are we going to go about navigating this?
Okay, so you just mentioned identity, and
yeah.
Identity is very closely connected to trust.
Yes.
Like, obviously, I'm not an expert on the US, but like from my European point
sure.
of view, like
yeah.
there's at the moment kind of a trust crisis. Like in the German media, we hear a lot of like
yeah.
fake news, mistrust
right.
between
right.
different parties.
Right.
So, what would you recommend the president in order to increase trust in
yeah.
the US, in the state, in each other, basically?
Yeah, yeah. So. I would actually suggest that one of the first things we do is question that assumption that we need to build trust, or that there is that in response to the crisis. So I completely know what you're talking about. Things are not at their best at the moment,
mm-hmm.
But a lot of times because we're being told that global levels of trust are low and distrust is high,
yeah.
we're told that it's a crisis of trust, and there's a crisis, but I don't think that the crisis is necessarily just that there's a lot of distrust or that we should just then focus on building trust, because when we focus on the fruit that we want, the trust, I think we go about it the wrong way. Instead, we need to start our focus by saying, how do we build trustworthiness? How do we establish and communicate our trustworthy character to our customers, to our colleagues, so that then when they really know us and we really know them, then trust follows naturally. But so often the discussion is about, well, how do we build trust? Because there's a crisis and it feels scary.
Yeah.
Right. It feels scary, and so we want to jump right into saying, let's just get trust back. But then that pushes us, I think, in directions which actually are not helpful when it comes
to
trust.
You're building pressure from the outside.
Exactly,
yeah,
exactly.
Yeah.
Instead, I think we need to be slowing down, focusing on trustworthiness, doing good work, doing the right thing, communicating that clearly. So I think a lot of times what we work with brands on is just saying, what are you doing really, really well? Where is your competence? Where do you have real integrity?
Mm-hmm.
And then how do you articulate that authentically to people so that they can see the trustworthiness that really is there?
Okay.
Yeah.
But from a philosophy
yes,
point
yeah.
of view, what's your definition of trust?
Yeah, good question. So my definition of trust is an optimistic acceptance of vulnerability. So what I mean
okay.
by that, to break it down, whenever trust is present, we're vulnerable.
Yeah.
So, but not just vulnerable to harm or something, we're vulnerable to being let down and betrayed. So if I trust you, then I'm necessarily in a position where you could betray me, right?
Yeah.
I'm vulnerable to you. But if I'm trusting you, I'm not just vulnerable, I'm also somehow optimistic, and I accept that vulnerability. I go, do you know what? You might betray me, but I'm going to take that risk, and I think I have some good reason to do so, and so I trust you. You know, if we're counting on people, but we're shaking on our boots the whole way, we're vulnerable, but we're not trusting. So I think the definition of trust, and going back to the to its roots and how we should think about it, is as this acceptance, optimistic acceptance of that vulnerability. And then how we think about it in that way really informs what we do. So I think if we recognize that vulnerability is present, then that means that we need to find ways to help other people be comfortable in the vulnerability, which is about knowing us rather than removing the vulnerability altogether. A lot of businesses that I see responding to threats and scandals and afterwards, what they tend to do, which is really normal and I understand it, but not helpful, what they tend to do is try to reduce vulnerability by increasing transparency or accountability or just moving everything to blockchain or something like that. And that's not helpful, because that's great if all you want is security and safety, but if you really want trust, which is richness of relationship and more, then it's not just about removing vulnerability, it's about having good reason to accept optimistically that vulnerability.
Okay, so if I go to a doctor, I know there is a knowledge gap. Yes. I trust this person because they have a better medical education, hopefully, than I do.
Yeah.
So I'm vulnerable, I trust them. But how does a company build this trust and makes me feel like they are as competent as the doctor that I trust?
Yeah. Well, so I think part of that, as with any kind of complex concept like trust, there's a lot to work through. But it's really fruitful when we do it. Mm-hmm. Because on the face of it, it can seem like this big question. How do we build trust with our users? How do we build trust with our customers? How do we get them to look at us like they would a doctor, right? And that's a big question. Take some work to get there, but it's really worthwhile. So what I would say is, actually, sometimes we trust doctors when we shouldn't, right? And to the extent that I just trust all doctors in the world because they're a doctor and wear a white jacket or whatever, my trust in some situations there is not well placed. And so I need to evolve my own degree of trust so that I say, I'm going to trust this doctor in particular because I know them, because I know that they are excellent in their professional ability, but also because I think they have my best interest at heart, and they're not just sort of, I don't know, getting money from other companies to tell me I need some surgery, right? Mm-hmm. So I would say the same thing applies to businesses. We don't just want more and more trust.
Yeah.
We want wise trust, because that's the trust that's going to stand the test of time. And I think the more and more that that connectivity is increased, that everyone has access to what's actually going on inside our businesses, the more and more we need to not settle just for any old trust, but we need to settle for wise, well-placed trust. And that goes right back to actual relationship. Are we communicating to others, you know, who we are? Do we know them? Are we on the same page?
Yeah, so trust about recommendations, transparency, and things like that.
Yeah.
But how do you think people can learn for themselves in order to judge their level of trust? Like when you just said, like it's about real trust, good trust.
Yeah.
Like how can consumers learn when to trust a company and when it's just a fake marketing message?
Yeah, that is a brilliant question and something that takes a lot of work. I think part of it is going back to testing. Well, first of all, setting aside a bit of headspace to reflect on it, right? Because it's, you know, I'm just the same as anyone else. I sometimes trust wisely, sometimes I trust unwisely, sometimes I distrust wisely. But there's a difference between distrust and what I'll call mistrust. A lot of times, at least in the UK where I'm living at the moment, the two terms are used interchangeably.
Okay.
But distrust is the absence of trust, whereas mistrust is specifically the sort of
negative
distrust running amok.
Yeah.
So misplaced distrust, right?
Okay.
So I might say, let's see, I hear about some scandal in an industry, and then I don't trust one company, and that might may be well placed, but then I start not trusting all other people in the industry.
Yeah.
That's not helpful, and that's not good. And if I'm honest, when I stop and think about it, I can kind of tell when my distrust is appropriate and when I'm just doing it because I'm angry. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Equally, I think when I'm trusting someone, I think I can also kind of tell when I know if I've done my due diligence and I've looked into things, there's a relationship, I have good reason to be trust someone, or if I'm just going, I'm not thinking about it, they're a doctor wearing a white lab coat, I'll trust them, right? So I think we need a lot of work having a bigger conversation in society, because there's a lot of pressure these days on brands to get it together and say, oh, after a scandal, it's their fault, they need to be more trustworthy, but actually think the rest of us also need to do some work to make sure that our distrust is well-placed and not running amok.
Yeah. So I read in your DMEXCO profile that philosophers at work is also, its mission is also to change the world for good. So one of my favorite quotes is that the world is not going to be a better place until philosophers become kings or kings become philosophers.
There we go. Yeah.
Do you think that there's a need of more philosophy in leading companies?
Definitely. So I think we need more philosophy in companies, but that doesn't necessarily we need what many of us think of as philosophy in companies. Mm-hmm. So sometimes I think philosophy is thought of as this dusty thing in the ivory towers that's just intellectual and not practical, right? And I don't think we need more of that in companies. Mm-hmm. That's not going to help us make the world a better place. But what we do need are the skills that philosophy tends to give you.
Yeah.
So things like curiosity, critical thinking, asking great questions, reflecting enough to slow us down and go, wait a minute, is this right, or are we just all a bit too busy, right? And that's really important. So whether or not that means, like a lot of Silicon Valley companies are doing now, hiring someone that calls themselves a philosopher to come into the business, or what I would rather see happen is actually more and more people in businesses being equipped with the skills of philosophy. So a lot of times what I do with my company Philosophy at Work is instead of me going in and being the philosopher to do that stuff, I come in and I do workshops helping people develop the way that they ask questions in their work, the way that they can cultivate cultures of curiosity, the way that when they're doing their strategy, they're doing really excellent critical thinking. It doesn't matter if they can quote Plato or do these sorts of things. The main thing is that they're thinking well, and that's what philosophy is all about.
That's a very nice closing statement.
Good.
Brennan, thank you so much for this interesting talk. I think we should start naming you Dr. Trust.
So
thank you very much for those interesting insights, and enjoy DMEXCO.
Thank you so much.
Thank
it's been
you.
A pleasure.